Friday. No, Thursday. Oh yeah, that's. So you did a lot of programming since then.
3D structure prediction, right?
Yeah. Put the modeling, I call it. Yeah. You'll notice the difference primarily tomorrow, I guess. So we talked about. So what is homology modeling? What is proving? So what is that main idea? So what do you do?
We know the structure of something, we can infer a structure of first-order sequences.
Yeah. So basically we do an alignment. Like some method of an alignment. We talk about some other alternative ideas today. And then we have basically as copied coordinates. So I think you will have a lab of that tomorrow. I think it's not today. I think it's after tomorrow. And of course, this is of course the main thing is of course that we actually this is the reason is that we have no sequence of we know the sequence of many more proteins than we know the structure. And most proteins. My idea is that if two proteins are homologs, if they have a common ancestor, they actually have a similar structure. And the number of possible structures is even kind of limited, probably. When the number of existing structures in nature. Because, of course, the number of families is probably limited also, so it's not really that surprising. But probably the number of structures is even lower. We talked a bit about these databases, SCOP and CATH. That's kind of actually I have a new favorite one. Let me talk about it. It's called Econ. This is the problem with SCOP and CATH, as a thing I told you yesterday. Or last week is that they are not really up to date. They're nice, but they are probably if you go to SCOP here, you can see the fantastic modern layout that it's not up to date. But in particular, you can see that the last release was June 2009.
Do they have the money to continue, or how
come? In this case, this was mostly done by this Alessio Mershon. This guy, and he is working on a SCOP 2.0 that is kind of fundamentally, there's even a link here, there's a fundamental new approach. Somehow he wants to divide the domains into different parts. So it's very much up to him. There is, maybe I don't have some time ago as there was here, but it's another way of getting things together, but I don't think they are. I don't think it's really up to date yet. So the thing is that he has basically has a manual classification. He looks at every structure. And there's some parts, if it's extremely similar to something else, you can do it automatically. But so it's somehow up to his his idea of defining what is similar, what is not similar. Of course, using tools. And of course, he's one person. And it's not the other. I'm sure he has a salary, but I'm sure he has a limited mind. All he knows, at least he used to know all the proteins in his head, so he might have, but it's kind of limited. But I'm sure he's more busy on this one. So idea is that you can have structural events and evolution events, you can divide things in the future. So it's probably interesting, but it takes a time. The CATH is more automatic, but it's still, this last one is almost 3 years old, so. And I think they might be at least partly limited on funding. I know they had a hard time getting funding sometime. I think they are working on it, but I haven't talked to Christina for a long time, so I'm not really sure. I would imagine that they work on it. But it's more automatic, but it's some parts or not. So this is what took over last year, I think, or 2 years ago, I was reading the paper. Well, and this is also because this guy Nick Christian is actually also a guy that knows every protein structure in his head, but he's much younger, so he's faster to work in. So that's, but it is similar. It has slightly different definition of categories, but the idea is very similar. And actually, it has a bit of like different order here, because you can find structures that are very homologs that are not always so structurally similar, because structures can change a little bit. So that's they all change the order a little bit here. But in general, it's the idea is the same. So you can go to all alpha here and do all bundles to find. Not alpha bundles, but you can find hierarchy here, so you can click on something else and get further down the hierarchy and so on. And you can, I guess you can look at the image of this one. So that is him, and this is up to date. At least used to be, the date is February 2nd, so it's whole week old. I talked to them, they basically, 99% is automatic, but then they have like a few cases every week that they have to classify manually. But they have a few people that sit to do that. Not as a full-time job, but they have a pipeline of things they need to go through manually a little bit. So today is 115,000 PDBs and 336,000 shades. Or last week it was like that. So this is probably what you should use today. There is also another SCOP 2 that is SCOP E2, I think. That is basically automatic extensions of the SCOP, but it's not really up to date. So that is, if you want this, you should change the lab to use this instead, but we haven't, I think. Mm-hmm. Okay, so back to homology modeling, or for the modeling, what else did we say? What is the key aspect of getting good structure, do you know? Is it?
Good sequence lining?
So basically, there's two things. A, is the structure similar to what you want to obtain? If you have one template, if the template is not similar, you're going to get bad. But that's, of course, you don't know in advance, but that's actually dependent on how similar the sequences are. So basically, the other half is fine. If you have a good template, you have the right alignment. And alignment is often the more difficult part of it. Because finding the template, you often do go inside, but often you don't. Is to do misalignments. You can have problems like, this is very illustrative, you actually miss the gaps in the wrong place, and then you get bad alignments for that, and that's
case worse more.
So you can do that. And we talked, a lot of people spend a lot of time looking at the quality of a model. A lot of people look at the quality, if you run three models, for instance, you get some output like this, and tells you how good each model, each position is in some kind of measure and energy, so that. Unfortunately, it's not that illustrative, because it's really you can have bad models that's completely wrong, and still have most of these parameters quite okay. So it really depends on the alignment. You can often get quite okay. There are some parameters you can lose. Improvements. Something else? Should we go on to today's lecture? Stop this recording.